This is the first of what we hope is a long tradition of speaker series at every one of our monthly meetings going forward. We're honored to have Comptroller Kevin Lembo here. Kevin was elected to a second four-year term as Connecticut State Comptroller in 2014, following 20 years of public service and advocacy. As State Comptroller, Kevin continues to lead the charge for affordable health care and quality health care, with an emphasis on access to preventative care and wellness programs. Comptroller Lembo leads ongoing initiatives to establish government transparency and accountability, fiscal stability through an improved budget reserve fund formula, better retirement savings options for all residents, and more affordable ultra-high-speed internet service for every business and household in the state. Comptroller Lembo serves as Connecticut's chief fiscal guardian, reporting on the state's financial status every month to ensure that Connecticut proceeds on a secure financial track, coordinating health care and payroll for hundreds of thousands of public employees and retirees, and administering the statewide electronic accounting system. He has been hailed by advocacy groups and the media as a champion of transparency for his efforts to promote public access to vital state financial information. In addition to serving as comptroller, Kevin has served as a clinical instructor at the Yale School of Nursing in the Nurse Management, Policy, and Leadership specialty. Comptroller Lembo holds a Master of Public Administration degree from California State University and is a member of the Pi Alpha Honor Society. He was named a Toll Fellow of the Council of State Governments in 2004 and has served as a panelist and moderator throughout the state and country as an expert in healthcare and retirement administration. We're honored with the Glasgow Democrat Town Committee to have Kevin Lembo for coming to the
So I'm not going to use this, just for starters. I'm going to make Luther crazy because I'm going to move all around. I'm sorry, Luther. It's good to see you all. Thank you for taking the time to be here this evening. It's a great opportunity for me to touch base and check in and see how things are going. And I said to Matt, and I think I said to Charlie when I walked in, I want to sort of update you on some of the things that I'm working on, let you know what I think we're going to see happening, at least a little bit, at the Capitol. And then open the floor and see what's on your mind. It's easy sometimes to get stuck in that building with the gold dome, which is very beautiful, but unless you get out and you talk to folks and you get some feedback and you hear what's on your mind, then we engage in that groupthink thing that we know is not very useful or helpful as you're trying to forward very important and complicated public policy ideas. So, without further ado, it's busy. Busy, busy, busy. We talked, I think, the last time we were together, but it may bear repeating. We worked on a big piece of legislation 2 years ago that I just want to put back on your radar because it actually ended up being a success. Connecticut has a couple of very volatile revenue streams. You know, that's part of having a progressive income tax, right? So when the market goes up, revenue comes floating in, and then when the market crashes, the money sort of goes away, which is fine if you do what our grandmothers or our mothers told us when we were growing up, and that's it, and that is, you got a $10 check for your birthday, that's great. $5 goes in the bank, $5 you get to spend. You can't spend every dollar that comes in the door because next time there may not be another check, right? You gotta prepare for these things. So we did some modeling. We looked at other states that had volatile revenue streams, like Connecticut, and we looked at our corporate tax and the part of the income tax that's tied to the quarterly filers, which is the most volatile of all of our revenue streams. And you can see budgets being built up to the new reality every time the market booms, and you can see taxes being increased and services being cut every time the market busts. So that does a lot of things. It creates a lot of unrest among people. Consumer confidence is eroded every time you have to cut again, or raise taxes for that matter. So I said, well, what if we look at this not on a two-year cycle or a three-year cycle, but on a 10-year cycle? What does this look like, the ups and downs of all this over 10 years, and then figure out what's the growth average in those 10 years and agree that we're not going to spend money above that 10-year growth average? Relatively simple concept, right? So we got all the models done. We sent them out. We had the academics stress test them. We used different periods of time. We said, okay, apply this model to 1992 and then run it forward and apply it every year from there to here. And let us know, sort of, does it do the things we wanted it to do? Models came back. They tweaked them a little bit, working really well. And then I had to go to the finance committee of the legislature to ask them to take up this idea. And this Irish-German kid raised in an Italian household had a little bit of what we call agita. You know, like laying in bed staring at the ceiling, realizing I'm asking them to do the hardest thing of all, and that is to say no. Tie their hands in good economic times so they don't have to do real damage the next time the market tanks. To a person, they all said yes. Democrats and Republicans, House and Senate, freshmen, veteran legislators, urban, suburban, rural, all said yes. Now, they said yes for different reasons. My Democratic colleagues, and I'm generalizing here, like the idea of being able to preserve programs at the worst of times, so that when people need things the most, they can actually get them. My Republican colleagues like the idea of putting downward pressure on spending, so there wasn't this exuberance, so we can keep things. But, you know, I don't care why they said yes. They said yes. This thing worked its way through. I sat at the table in front of the Finance Committee with the Yankee Institute on one side of me and Connecticut Voices for Children on the other side. Now, arguably left and right of center by any measure. And we all testified that this bill needed to happen, passed unanimously in the Finance Committee, was transmitted to the floor. Now, here's where it got a little weird. Our friends on the Democratic side of the aisle decided they didn't want the Republicans to vote on this because it was going to be a good piece of legislation and they didn't want to let them have the feather in their cap. Mm-hmm. Now, the good government guy in me is like, come on, right? Here's an example of how we can actually work together. Nobody got hurt here. We all like figured this out and we all move forward together. So it got buried in the budget because they knew they wouldn't vote for the budget. And it got a 2020 effective date put on it. Not ideal. There was rumblings about a veto, and then the 2020 effective date was attached to it, and we were told it would be allowed to go with that effective date. So now, you know, right? I remember coming here my very, very first time, and Pat, I think, was chair at the time, and asking you to support me for this run for comptroller. You didn't know me from a hole in the ground. I was a guy who followed Nancy Wyman around sometimes, and then I went off, and I got to be the healthcare advocate for 6 years, and now I'm back asking for your support for statewide office. But one of the bits I've learned since that time is that 3/4 of a loaf is better than no loaf at all. I was headed toward no loaf, and so the law has passed. It's on the books. The effective date can be turned up to today, anytime, at the legislature and or the governor choose. But it's part of a larger conversation about how do we get Connecticut really back on track? How do we figure out how to stop this boom and bust cycle? How do we get to a place where we see the growth that we've experienced for many, many years in the past? And I'm really bullish about that. You know, despite the challenges, despite the hard work, we have so many strengths. Productivity of our workforce, PhDs per capita, our teaching hospitals, our academic institutions, our financial industry, the manufacturing base, all of those things together are our strengths, and all of those strengths can wash away all of the challenges if we do what we're supposed to do. And when I say we, I mean government, and what I think what we need to do is send some messages about growth, consistency, predictability, be really clear about what our values are, but not be changing the rules and changing the rules of the game every time someone decides they need to be changed. That consistency over time, more than almost anything else, including changes in the tax code that may benefit a certain group of people, is really what folks are after. Because then they can plan around whatever it is and know that it will be pretty much that 5 years out, or 10 years out, or hopefully even more. So the second big block that's been really giving most of us angst and agita over the last number of years is the pension liability. We've all heard it. We heard GE, as they were leaving, say, a pox on both your houses. We hate you for this reason, we hate you for that reason, we hate you for this reason, and you got that pension liability as well that you need to get under control. So I'll set their rationale aside for a second and acknowledge that the pension liability is a huge deal. That is a growing cost, a fixed cost, and it's crowding out so many other things that anybody who's paying attention knows that there's only two alternatives as you start to approach a $6 billion payment, and those are tax increases or service cuts. Like there's no way out besides one of those two things. But the third alternative is to wrangle that big number. So in 1992, Lowell Weicker looked at the unfunded liability in the pension fund and said, well, we gotta pay this off. It's a debt to the fund. We gotta make sure we resolve it, and put us on a flat 40-year payoff, like a 40-year home mortgage at a fixed rate, flat over time. And then when you adjust that number for inflation, you know, it becomes less of a burden on the whole as you go out further. 1997, those who will remain nameless, who happened to be in charge at the time, give you time to figure out who that was, decided that flat and predictable was not their thing. So even though we were throwing off $300 and $400 million budget surpluses, they decided that they still wanted to take their payment down. So they took it down, refinanced the debt, and put us on the path of a balloon mortgage. So went from a 40-year fixed to a balloon mortgage. And suddenly it looks like we're in more house than we can afford, right? Because the payment starts going up. But if they had just left it alone, we would have been able to weather all of this. But it is what it is. The can was kicked down the road. Bad decisions were made in the past. We can blame everybody all day long, but the can was kicked and it's landed now right in our laps. So we've got to do something about it. That pension fund payment grows at $100 million a year. It was $1.5 billion last year, and it will be $6 billion by 2032 at the rate it's going. And that's only if all the assumptions in there hold. And we all know that they don't. Right? The market never does everything we think it's going to do. So it's on its way up. So the governor, to his credit, engaged Boston College, I think it was, and they did a retro look, like how did we get here? And then put a six-point plan on how do we wrangle this and fix it as we go forward. Nobody's going to be surprised. And you know you elect us independently. I agreed with three things, I disagreed with three things. That's just the way it goes. If you want us to bring our best thinking, sometimes people are going to disagree about this stuff. He wanted to take the rate down, the assumption rate in the fund down from 8 down to 7 or below. I supported that. There were a couple of other pieces. And then there were some other pieces about taking our tier one employees and putting them as on a pay-as-you-go system, doing an open amortization period, which doesn't mean much except to the actuaries and accountants in the room. But that said, it's one thing to snipe from the sidelines, but if you're going to disagree, you've got to put your money where your mouth is and get in. So we designed a plan. And it took this, and it did this. So you see the theme, right? Volatility in the taxes, bring it down. Get this big thing, wrangle it under, get it under control. Because it's the only way out. So we did some work, passed that on to both the Malloy administration and to CBAC. They went to the bargaining table and came out with a deal. That deal is going to be voted on February 1st, and it will do all the things that we need it to do. Now, is it ideal? No, it's not ideal. Does it cure cancer? It does not cure cancer. Our opponents to this now, who've been sniping forever, are saying it doesn't cure cancer and it kicks the can down the road. Well, yeah, technically, with our younger workers, it extends the amortization period another 9 years from 25 plus 9. But that was just to get the payment at $2.2 billion. But once it's at $2.2 billion, it's flat into the future until it's paid off. The agreement is a good agreement. I hope they pass it, and it'll help to stabilize the state's books going forward. I met with the House Democratic Caucus today and worked through some of these issues. The folks are ready. They're hungry and they're eager to actually do the hard work that's necessary. And look, working with legislatures or groups or caucuses or coalitions, or it's harder than saying, you do this, you do that. That's easy, right? I do that at home all the time. Wash the dishes. But you gotta, you know, these are co-equal branches of government. You gotta bring everybody together, and whenever you can, you gotta figure out a way to work together. It takes longer, it's more complicated, but at the end, much more satisfying. And if you're willing to check your ego at the door a little bit, you sometimes realize that I don't always have the best idea, and you get other ideas that actually come and are superior to the one that you thought you had. So I'm pretty hopeful. So we did those two things. We did transparency, as Matt mentioned in the introduction, continue to march on the transparency path, and that's going well. Wrangling a little bit now on the economic development front, trying to figure out, can we continue to do what we've been doing around economic development? I think the answer to that is no. I think at the bottom of an economic trough and a recession, the government has a significant role in keeping the gears of industry moving, whether it's the federal government or state, because you don't want those gears to seize up, right? You want it to keep moving. So you could be in there adding capital, infusing things into the market. But as things start to pick up, it's really our job to step back. Because otherwise, we're just picking this pizza joint over that pizza joint. I like your pizza. I don't like your pizza. If you're serving bad pizza and the price is too high, you need to go out of business. I mean, it's Connecticut, we've got good pizza. Let's not drop pizza joints. The other end of that spectrum, however, is making the hard decisions about what is the philosophy. Just like trickle-down economics doesn't work, trickle-down economic development theory doesn't work. Trickle-down economic development theory goes something like this. I need to make sure there's revenue coming into the state. I'm gonna take this, I'm gonna throw it up at the top, and I know the revenue's gonna come in through their income taxes next time. That cycles revenue. It'll bring a couple more folks at the top and money will come in. But it's not sustainable because the bucket empties out after a while and you can't keep throwing it up the hill. And unless you grow the middle, unless you create an environment where businesses that are suppliers to Pratt & Whitney can enlarge and improve, unless you target your economic development on manufacturing, for example, that allows our kids who may not be destined to go to the Ivy League, but rather are really good with their hands, or really good with math, or really good with trigonometry, and you know, they can go through the community technical colleges and hit the shop floor with $50,000 or $60,000 or sometimes even $70,000 job. That grows the economy in a much more natural way. And it gives that opportunity for folks who struggle to get into the middle class a place where they can reasonably leap. Mm-hmm. You know, we always hear the stories about the kid who came from nothing and struggled and then catapulted up to the rarefied air of the financial world. I mean, that's a beautiful story. But that's the exception rather than the rule. How do we create a place that allows those folks who we claim to care about to come up into the middle class? And how do we enlarge that strata of the middle class to allow the people who are struggling to stay there to be able to stay there as well? Now, yeah, we've seen job growth, but we see incomes more. We see job growth, but people are going back to work at jobs that pay less than the ones that they lost before the recession started. And that's really nobody's fault per se, because the market changes. But if we target our resources in the right place, we can, in a natural way, grow what's already growing. I voted no on the Bridgewater deal.
Sorry.
Thank you, Alan. look, it was a $22 million item for the largest hedge fund in the world. And I want to be clear that I have no quarrel with the folks who work in the hedge fund. I absolutely have none. But the deal went something like this. We're going to take $22 million in bonded state money, your money, and we're going to turn it over to Bridgewater. And when we do that, they're going to put $500 million of their dollars on the table. Now, I don't care if it's physics or math, 22 does not leverage 500. 22 doesn't leverage 500. 22 sends a message. We want to be in. We want you to stay. That's fine. But it doesn't put them in a situation where they're going to hire 700 new finance managers that they may or may not need. These are the most sophisticated financial players out there. They are not going to do that unless they need to do it. And unless the ROI, the return on investment for those hires, is substantially more than what it will cost to bring them on board. So I voted no, saying if it was 22 $1 million manufacturing assistance grants, I'd be on board, but I got to vote no. And then, of course, the flying monkeys got released. Because, you know, you only do that if you aspire, or you're only doing that because you're trying to make a point, or you're only doing that to kick sand on the governor, you're only doing this to do this other thing. When you're a hammer, everything looks like a nail. When you're a political animal only, everything is a political question. This is a policy question. This is a values question. And you may not agree with me, and that's okay. But I hope you know that I did it because I thought it was not the right deal. And at the end of the day, I hope that's what you ask of all of us, is to bring our best experience, our values, as you understand them, to each of these decisions that get made. I'm not Pollyanna. I can throw elbows with the best of them if need be. Not the best of them, I'm not that good. But generally, it's about the policy. And if we get the policy right, politics takes care of itself. But if you lead with the politics, more often than not, we lose. Mm-hmm. So with that, I'm gonna zip my lip and happily open the floor to any questions you may have.
Yes. Yeah. Your office administers the state employees disability retirement program.
Yes, we do.
What is your feeling as to whether the disabled state employees should have a right to a hearing to prove their disability?
Right now you do.
It's not an on-the-record hearing. It's not a hearing.
Well, so when I came into the office, it was very much a closed process. And there were a couple of docs who were doing it. The backlog was a couple of years sometimes to get a determination on a disability retirement. We've revamped that. We standardized paperwork. We made the expectations clear. We hired panels of outside doctors who have no dog in the fight. And that has sped up the processing of those hearings. There was a little bit of back and forth about, should this be an open hearing? Should it be a closed hearing? Who should be able to have a witness? Should you be able to have an attorney with you? Should you be able to just make a statement of impact on your life when it's really a medical determination that's being made? You can get a hearing before the medical examining board. It takes time to get in the queue.
It's not an on-the-record hearing. There's no right to appeal. Without the hearing, there's no right to appeal.
You appeal back to the retirement commission.
And appeal to court. There's no right to appeal.
After you exhaust your administrative functions within the retirement division, then you have a right to go to court.
Well, give me that statute because I'm not aware of that.
Well, it's the regulations. You can call the office and I'm happy to get it for you. Other questions?
Could you address the issue with the state employees campaign for charitable giving, the issue that happened? I ask that because I think there's a lot of misunderstanding out there and probably not from people in this room, but I
sure.
just want people to be able to explain it. And I say that as a state employee who's contributed to the state employees campaign, I previously donated to Best Buddies, which is an organization that supports children with developmental disabilities and helps them become friends. And that organization was cut off the employee's campaign because somebody made too much money on their Form 90, 900 or whatever the tax
The administrative is. Costs of
right.
the
Right, so that's a policy question of the comptroller's office that if you go above this level, then you can't. They
right.
won't be allowed to participate in a campaign. So just ask you to address sort of what happened.
Sure. So I was referring to the American Family Association.
Couldn't remember the name of the organization,
yeah,
okay.
sorry. So just to recap quickly, and I don't know if anybody followed this, but it was sort of interesting. We got a complaint from a deep employee, Department of Energy and Environmental Protection. Thank you, Tyler, sitting in the audience and trying to prompt me from there. That there was a charity in the book that looked like they didn't comply with Connecticut's non-discrimination rules. And the rule of participating in the plan is, as a charity, your administrative fees can't be above a certain level, you have to actually provide a direct service, and you have to have some sort of board resolution or a policy of your organization that says your policies in hiring and in service delivery don't violate Connecticut's non-discrimination laws. And we all know that our non-discrimination laws are a bit broader than Mississippi. Not that there's anything wrong with Mississippi, but that happens to be where they're located. So the complaint came in because this person saw this organization in the book and then had heard some stuff that their leadership was saying in the national media and said, these two things don't seem to square, that you would say these things and have that policy. So we looked into it and asked them to provide a copy. They ultimately said, I'm paraphrasing, God said we don't have to. You know, it was one of these like, well, we're above all this. We don't have to do anything that we just have a right to be here. But before they did that, they unleashed their folks, they were a national radio network, and unleashed them and essentially said that the gay comptroller was using his, because of his bias, was attacking them And it had just been a document request at that point. I don't know how you get to attack, but, but that's what we were. And 17,000, last count, 17,800 emails came into my inbox. Phone calls came in from all over the country, shut down the switchboard. Our retirees, our employees couldn't like communicate with the office. And look, that's what they did, right? So, and so that went on for a while, and then it stopped. Went back to them and said, you know, we're still just waiting on some paper. Are you going to do this or not? They said no. And then the committee, it's a volunteer committee that oversees the plan. It's administratively with our office, voted to exclude them from the program. Now, they've appealed that, and it will go to CHRO, Human Rights and Opportunities, for a declaratory ruling about whether they actually were in violation or not. So it's sort of out of our hands at this point, and it'll come back, and we're going to be bound by whatever that decision is. So it's, I think it's been portrayed in a way that is inaccurate. It really was looking on the face of the argument and saying, these two things don't fit, and then turned into just a bit of a circus.
So you didn't negotiate it, number one, and you're applying a policy just like they applied it to Best Buddies, right, for a different reason you're applying
the state law demands that anybody who participates in the program comply with our non-discrimination law, whether you're domiciled in Tupelo, Mississippi, or in Norwich. You have to comply with these rules. It's just the way it is. You have no constitutional right to participate in this plan, and the values of the people of Connecticut are reflected in this non-discrimination policy. So if you're gonna enjoy the benefit of participating in this Connecticut plan, you gotta get on board, and if not, not.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I had a lot of publicity about the pensions, you know, being accelerated by, let's say, legislators joining the administration at a huge salary for 2 or 3 years, or other employees getting a lot of overtime in the last 3 years. You know, number one, what can be done about that? And number two, what impact does that have on the pensions overall?
Yep. So, look, any negative, so any spiking of pensions, any, you know, any employee that goes from a $30,000 a year legislator to a $150,000 agency head for a couple of years is going to sort of throw the actuarial tables off a little bit, because it's not anticipated. You expect an employee who comes in at $40,000 to make $45,000 and then $50,000, and then, you know, you don't expect them to do that. It has a significant impact. But it's on the edges, because when you think about the body of people who participate in this plan, they take a pretty traditional path in their career, those that remain with us for a long time, and our assumptions are built mostly around them and their experience. Now, that said, it sends a pretty rough message out when we're saying, you know, things are bad, you know, we can't afford this, the pension's, you know, crushing us, like all of this, and then you see that kind of stuff happen. The calculation of overtime, the how legislators use mileage as part of their reimbursement is all either in statute or in agreement or in a collective bargaining agreement. So those are all, we're bound to those agreements until they're renegotiated. On the state employee side, on the collective bargaining side, 2022 is the end of the contract that we're in right now. And unless both parties decide they want to open it back up, it's going to stay sealed just the way it is. What really sticks in my craw is when I listened to it for a decade to certain legislators rail against defined benefit pensions, scream about the fat employees at the trough, fat whole thing, and then as soon as they're offered an opportunity, they're back, they're up in the rarefied air, you know, like collecting their money. That, and then like there's no hypocrisy here. It's like, well, why not? It's like, well, why not? You said you were philosophically opposed, that this was inconsistent, that your constituents could not afford this, and you've just blown the actuarial table. I mean, like, thank you? I want to stand in the front of the, like, on the opening day of session when everybody's in the same chamber and say, like, if you really are offended by your health care, please put your card in this basket. Like, just come on. Nobody says you've got to take it. Make a stand. Take a stand. Mm-hmm. Step away. But that's not going to happen. It's, you know, both sides in the mouth. When you look at the defined benefit pension plan that we have, the design now, tier 2, 2A, tier 3, not the tier 1 employees, because that was a little bit of a richer, a lot of a richer benefit. is right in the center of DB plans around the country of its size. There's nothing that outrageous about the plan. The normal cost, as I've said before, $1.5 billion was what the state paid to the pension plan. It's got two elements. Normal cost, which is a reflection of our employees and what their future retirement benefit is going to look like, and then the unfunded liability, which they really had no say in at all. $1.2 billion of $1.5 is on the unfunded liability. The normal cost is this low, flat number that actually has shrunk over years as we put in Tier 2A and Tier 3. So there is not, it's like the folks who wanted to destabilize Social Security to just say that Social Security didn't work. It almost feels to me like there was an intentional destabilization of this thing. So we could say, see. And it's fine to say 401k, and it's fine to say we should talk about a hybrid for our employees, particularly our younger employees who may not stay for 20 or 30 years, who may come in for five and should be able to take a front-end 401k with them as they go. That's a reasonable conversation to have. But even if you moved all of those employees to 401ks tomorrow, if you had the legal authority to do it, the pension obligation is still there. It's going to have to be satisfied. So then where's the money going to come from to do that, particularly when you've got employees who are contributing to that plan? It's like, we're going to repeal and replace Obamacare. Well, with what? And as soon as you say, well, I like that thing, and I like that thing, and I like that thing, but I don't like all those things. I like the age 26, I like the no pre-existing condition, we like all that stuff, but we don't like the mandate, we don't like the requirement that people, yeah, okay, but you can't have that without this, because it all balances itself out. So, you know.
Touching on the Affordable Care Act, in the worst case scenario, if it gets repealed in some form or fashion, is there any thought at the state level to do a mini version like Massachusetts had? And would that take, you know, years to accomplish, or is that something that could be put in place so that we don't have a lot of people going off of the insured?
So the good news about it is that Connecticut, unlike other states, built its own front end, right? The Access Health CT is its own front end. We've already sunk the costs in to build that thing. And so that front end mechanism could work no matter what the back end insurance options look like. The question will be the subsidization piece. You know, what do the subsidies look like? And depending on what they do with Medicaid, we may be in a situation where Connecticut's level of funding from the feds for Medicaid and to subsidize the Affordable Care Act participants will be so much less that we're going to have to decide where is that money going to come from, and when you're going to eke out a fiscal year maybe in balance. You know, I put out that we were going to be 50 some odd million in deficit. Now the new revenue numbers are in and the new consensus projections are in, and George Jepson, God love him, got a $31.5 million settlement from Moody's. Like, all of that together helps to balance out this year. But we're not in a position to say, okay, we've got another $250 million sitting here to continue the subsidies as we had before. So it's going to be a nightmare for those people who came in and either got access to Medicaid or a heavily subsidized private sector plan when those subsidies go away and their ability to stay on Medicaid goes away as well, which is highly possible. Mm-hmm. Peter.
The recent change in the makeup of the state legislature, most notably in the Senate, your thoughts on this legislative session? Will a lot get accomplished? Nothing get accomplished? Will we get an honest budget at the end of the session? Does anyone know?
So I don't think anybody really knows. I think I go back and forth between being hopeful, because I see some committee processes going much more efficiently than they may have gone in the past. There seems to be a front-end agreement about what they're going to do. They're sticking to that and trying to work together to get that done. I had a meeting with the finance chairs today. I've been in around state government now for 20 years almost. I've never walked into a meeting where there was the majority-minority. Like, all the chairs were in one room, and I pitched this thing once. Normally, I've got to go to the Republican senator, the Republican House person, you know, Democrats. So that could make for efficiency. What they actually decide on is anybody's guess. I think it's, you know, it's an interesting story to think that Nancy will be, you know, Nancy Wyman will be the one breaking all the ties and things will go on as usual. Every story about the Three Amigos that's been run recently, you know, there are certain legislators, senators in particular, who are, you know, tend to be more moderate, could go either way on some issues. They're the ones who are going to sort of throw that conversation inside the Senate chamber. It's going to be more interesting to me to actually watch the House. The margin is not there as it was. There's a bigger group of people who either will find something, you know, not progressive enough or maybe not conservative enough, and they could actually turn that into a bit of a challenge as well, which will just mean the number of bills that get passed is fewer. And that may not be a bad thing, because sometimes there's a lot of bills. Nick, there was a day, and I'm looking at Nick, that there was some committee-level discipline around what bills actually got raised. And lately, it feels like, you know, almost everything that comes in gets raised by the committee, gets a hearing, you know, goes through the whole process. I think less is more as a general strategy right now. I think Connecticut government would benefit from a less is more approach to all of this. Get back to our knitting a little bit, figure out what we're here, what we're supposed to be doing, get ourselves off the front page of the Hartford Current, top of the news, top of the radio news as well. We're not the story. State government's not the story. If we do this well, we don't think about us. It's when we're like making ourselves the story, or there's so much tumult going on that, you know, then there we are all the time. And that has a ripple effect that's pretty horrible. So that's a very long way of saying, don't know, not yet, too soon.
Kevin, what's the anticipated deficit this year, and what is the plan to attack that?
So the deficit for this year is, again, when I did January 1st, which was my last report, I was at 56.2, I think. Now with the new consensus revenue numbers, it's interesting to see what has happened. Corporate taxes have gone up significantly, $80 million over what had been expected. There's a little bump in sales, I believe, as well. I'm trying to do this all from memory. The withholding portion of the income tax, however, is off again. It was moving in a positive direction. That's really problematic because that's the tax that most of us pay out of our paychecks and settle up in April. And it's a real reflection of the financial health of Connecticut families. What's going on at the kitchen table, you see it reflected in the withholding. So those numbers are a little bit off. When you take that together with the Moody's settlement, we can probably balance out this year if everything keeps moving the way it's moving, which gets us to zero, maybe even a little bit of a surplus because of the very ambitious savings targets within agency budgets. It's when you get out into the out years. So I would not put a whole lot of confidence in the consensus revenue number as an element of the trend going out, because it has defied us every single time. Every time you think, okay, we've got 18 months worth of data, 12 months worth of data, we can sit here and project out and figure out where it's going to be, you get what looks like a double dip. You get something else that happens, and suddenly you're back in deficit again. So they're going to have to work hard, especially if there's a little bit of a surplus, to keep new stuff at bay in the budget and try to keep it as close to its present construction as possible.
So maybe I missed it, but the what I recall was the dire warnings that we're going to have a huge deficit this year that we're going to have to deal with. It sounds like you're fairly optimistic about that.
I think in anything that may end up as a tail this year, there's not much left in the rainy day fund, but there's a little bit that we can use. It's really the out years. It's really next year where obviously the governor's budget address has to stay on February 8th, I think. I would peg the out year deficit as $1.135 billion before the consensus revenue changes. I'm not ready to. We don't do a lot of out-year projecting. That's not our, we do most this year budget monitoring, and then may have things to say about the out-years. But I don't think it'll be 1.135, but every time I say that, you know, I'm wrong, so. Oh.
Yeah, and just on that current year deficit, the governor had some pullbacks on ECS and municipal aid. Is it balanced with those? Pullback, or I'm on the Board of Ed, and we're looking at $232,000. I mean, it's not going to ruin us, but
it's the stuff that was done about 4 months ago or 5 months ago.
relatively recently, over the holiday, late December.
That's packed into there.
So that's still gone.
That's already in there. Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry. Okay.
Oh. That's gone.
Yeah.
the stock market going up the way it has in the last year, how come we're not seeing more revenue from that? Or maybe that's what we are seeing, is that $80 million. But I mean, since we are such a volatile state with the progressive income tax, how come that's not really translating to more income?
I think generally it is. I think there was the belief that, remember the whole Bush tax cut thing, and people were taking losses, and there were a whole bunch of things happening. We thought for sure there would be some capital gains realized at that point. Folks rebalanced, and so we took a hit that year, and then folks rebalanced their portfolio in the second year, and so they didn't sell as much. They added stuff back in, so there wasn't a realization of gains at that point. You see a little bit of sell-off this year. The number actually for January looks a little bit better than anticipated, but that quarterly filer portion of the income tax, while it's a small number of people, it's a pretty significant dollar amount, and can really, there were folks who thumped their chest and said, you know, we knew that that wasn't going to perform the way you said it was. It's like, well, you who? You is consensus revenue, meaning the nonpartisan budget of fiscal analysis, together with the always partisan OPM, no matter who the governor is, it's a partisan office, have to come to consensus. So, okay, Republican legislator, you knew what the market was going to do a year from now and you didn't tell anybody? I wish you had told me, because I probably could have put a couple of chits down in places that would have paid off. I think that's probably federal jail, but you know, it didn't happen, so it's not wrong. It is not recovering as it has historically. We have lost some folks in that upper band. They're gone. There have been some changes in the way they're managing their money. There's an aging of that population as well. They've shifted a lot of their investment away from volatile stock portfolios to more manageable sort of mutual fund, low administrative in some cases. So you're seeing that pay out. So when they did the tax increases a couple of years ago and targeted that class, the revenue didn't flow as it normally did, because those people are doing different things with their money than they had done before. It's going to be a hard conversation. We're going to have to talk about the estate tax, the gift tax, and some of us say, well, you know, we don't want that to go away, but we're going to have a conversation about it, because if it is, in fact, and I'm not saying it is yet, driving flight in those categories, then it's rational, even though painful, for us to talk about ways to make that less bad in their view, without giving away the store. There's a way to do both of these things and balance it all, but it's not chasing them to the border and begging them not to go. You know, that's never going to work. I think Matt said I had about 10 minutes.
Yeah.
I think I nailed it, 10 minutes. No, one more?
Are you going to get invited by the Republican equivalents of this group? Do you only just speak to Democrats?
No, you know, I don't. I speak to pretty much anybody who will have me.
Well, yeah.
The Republican town committees tend not to invite.
Well, that's the thing.
It's too bad. I was in Westport last year at the Democratic Town Committee of Westport, and literally there, where they meet in Town Hall, I think it was, the rooms are like glass from the mid-wall up, and so all the meeting rooms, you can see everything that's going on in other rooms. The Republicans were meeting at the exact same time, exact same place across the hall. I could see them. And so I poked my head in and said, hey,
yeah,
I'm happy to come and talk to you if you ever want me to, you know. And they were like, yes. They wanted me to stay away.
So we could suggest in this time.
Yep.
Get some information, guys.
Yeah. Right.
Yes.
All been all done?
Oh, thank you.
It's great to see you all. Okay, they're going to hold, they told me they were going to put dinner aside for me, so with your indulgence, I'm going to go do that.
Thank you.